The Cuban Missile Crisis was one of the most tense periods in American history, with 13 days threatening the safety of the world and setting a precedent for the future of nuclear warfare. The dispute between American President John F. Kennedy and Soviet leaders Fidel Castro of Cuba and Nikita Khrushchev of the USSR represented one of many Cold War conflicts in a long-standing arms race between the United States and the Soviet Union. Failures to communicate and misperceptions caused the Cuban Missile Crisis to be one of the most tense and perilous times of the Cold War. Origins. European powers faced a long road to recovery after World War II. The United States and USSR emerged as world superpowers in the aftermath, as most of their territory remained unscathed. Due to ideological differences and growing foreign policy tensions, both sides grew their nuclear arsenals for military dominance. During this period, a young Fidel Castro successfully revolted against dictator Fulgencio Batista in the Cuban Revolution. After assuming power, he severed all economic ties with the United States, including resorts, oil, and crop industries. This act of aggression angered then-President Eisenhower, who looked to distance himself and cut communications with the once ally of the U.S. During the 1960 United Nations Conference in New York, Eisenhower excluded Cuba from the Assembly of Latin American Nations, while later in the General Assembly, Castro delivered a record 4.5-hour speech denouncing American policies towards Cuba and praising the Soviet Union. Less than a year later, Eisenhower ordered the CIA to recruit Cuban exiles and train them to dethrone Castro and his regime. This became known as the Bay of Pigs invasion. Bay of Pigs invasion / lead up. The Bay of Pigs invasion was the largest-scale attempt at overthrowing Fidel Castro's dictatorship in Cuba. The CIA rounded up and trained anti-Castro Cuban refugees in Guatemala for an attack on the southern coast of Cuba. That being said, the operation was not covert, with the New York Times even reporting on the training in 1960. Additionally, Eisenhower's term ended that year, and John F. Kennedy was to take office during the time of the invasion. Here, the CIA crucially miscommunicated to Kennedy, with CIA Inspector Generals Lading admitting they, quote, failed to advise the president at an appropriate time that success had become dubious, and to recommend that the operation therefore be canceled. Because of this, the invasion proceeded with insufficient soldiers. Kennedy, a diplomatic politician, wanted to disguise all U.S. involvement in the raid, telling the world,
will not be under any conditions be an intervention in Cuba by United States Armed Forces.
To avert suspicion, Kennedy called off secondary airstrikes, leaving Cuban defenses intact. This left the invading force vastly outnumbered, and the anti-Castro recruits sent were either killed or captured in a matter of days. Not only did the failure become an embarrassment to the Kennedy administration, but it more importantly made Fidel Castro a U.S. adversary and an ally of the Soviet Union. Prior to the crisis, the U.S. had installed ballistic missiles in Turkey, within striking range of the Soviets. Khrushchev utilized his newfound relationship with Castro to have the same advantage over the U.S., and on July of 1962, Soviet missiles were transported to Cuba, disguised under crates and equipment to avoid CIA detection. Upon arrival, they were positioned in forest areas and primed to reach almost all major cities in the United States. Crisis. On October 14, 1962, CIA U-2 planes captured images of an SS-4 construction site at San Cristobal in the Pinar del Rio province. On the morning of October 16, the CIA notified John F. Kennedy of the presence of the missiles, and the crisis officially began. Immediately after hearing the news, Kennedy assembled the Executive Committee of the National Security Council, or XCOM, to deliberate possible actions. The communists had lied on the type of missiles present, with Soviet Ambassador Anatoly Dobrynin falsely telling Kennedy, quote, all our deliveries, Mr. President, were of a defensive nature. Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara described this as, quote, a clear intent to deceive, and possible responses were considered. National Security Council members and military generals wanted an all-out invasion on Cuba, while Kennedy preferred a peaceful end of the situation. On October 22nd, Kennedy delivered a historic address to the world, detailing the presence of the missiles and proposing his solution.
To halt this offensive buildup, a strict quarantine on all offensive military equipment under shipment to Cuba is being initiated. All ships of any kind bound for Cuba, from whatever nation or port, where they're found to contain cargoes of offensive weapons, be turned back.
The message was received with mixed reactions around the world, with senators and European powers praising Kennedy's choice, while Soviets and far-right conservatives protested the blockade. The period after the announcement also marked a unique time of communication between the United States and the Soviet Union. While the situation was rapidly developing, telegraph between the nations took up to 2 days to deliver, often making the message outdated by then. The lack of communication and commanding chains led to confusion on whether to attack or stay neutral, potentially leading to full-scale war between the two sides. In his speech, Kennedy describes the perils of nuclear war with the USSR, but gives the US's stance in the situation.
We will not prematurely or unnecessarily risk the course of worldwide nuclear war, in which even the fruits of victory would be ashes in our mouth. But neither will we shrink from that risk at any time it must be faced.
A peaceful solution was ultimately found through communication between the two leaders and a mutual desire for peace. After an initial rejection of the blockade, Khrushchev writes, quote, "You, Kennedy, are showing concern for the preservation of peace, which I note with satisfaction." On October 28th, the USSR agreed to withdraw their missiles in Cuba as long as the United States did not invade and they dismantled their missiles in Turkey. This solution became one of the most prominent examples of positive communication through diplomacy in history. Aftermath. The world breathed a sigh of relief as World War III had been averted. Castro was furious upon discovering the warheads were being removed, and Cuba remained militarily armed and aggressive following the crisis. That being said, both the USSR and USA considered the outcome a victory. Khrushchev effectively defended communist Cuba from a US invasion and had negotiated the removal of their missiles in Turkey. Kennedy kept the support of Americans by standing up to the USSR and removed nuclear missiles in Cuba without starting a war. In 1963, both men signed the Partial Test Ban Treaty, prohibiting the test detonations of all nuclear weapons except underground. This was a monumental step in curbing the negative effects of testing and a first step to the end of the arms race. Both leaders were globally praised for showing restraint during this crisis. However, Khrushchev's rivals in the Kremlin were angered at his compliance with the United States, and on October 14th, 1964, he was ousted from office and replaced with Leonid Brezhnev. Following the crisis, the need for open communication also became evident. In 1963, a direct hotline was installed from Washington to Moscow, infamously known as the Red Phone. While the Red Phone was not an actual telephone line, it became a symbol of communication to give both nations and the world confidence in US-Soviet diplomatic relations. Implications. The risk of the Cuban Missile Crisis led to a period known as détente, where increased negotiations and a, quote, thawing of relationships between the United States and the Soviet Union occurred. Soviet Premier Leonid Brezhnev described it by saying, quote, "Détente is a readiness to resolve differences and conflicts, not by force, not by threats and saber-rattling, but by peaceful means at the conference table." The previously mentioned Red Phone greatly contributed to this idea, as it fostered open communication between the two powers. Both nations benefited from the improved relationship that came about during this period, as the arms race was extremely costly. The idea of Cold War détente created after the Cuban Missile Crisis had far-reaching implications, with numerous presidents and premiers making attempts at peace over the 3 decades following the event. Examples include President Lyndon B. Johnson meeting with Soviet Premier Alexei Kosygin at the Glasgow Summit in 1967, President Richard Nixon meeting with Premier Leonid Brezhnev during his visit to Washington in 1973, and more recently, President Barack Obama meeting with Cuban leader Raul Castro, brother of Fidel Castro, in Havana in 2016. The pursuit of better and more open relations persevered through decades of controversy, competition, and disagreements, and it would not have been able to occur without the historic Cuban Missile Crisis. Thank you.